morning, everyone. Is it working?
Yes.
Okay. But I don't start with the slide, huh? First thing is to revise what we have done a couple of times, but the important concept, which is commonly reported in literature, which is risk ratio. And we did that at least on two occasions, which I remember. And but in relation to a treatment step, right? It's also used for any epidemiological study, but since we were talking about randomized controlled trial, which is mainly about intervention, so we tailored it to the reporting of randomized trials. So when you report randomized trials, and I showed you the other day, this the randomized trial of tocilizumab, which was reported in NEJM, that used a risk ratio. So, and it was about mortality, if I remember correctly, mortality or intubation, some mechanical intubation. So, which ratios are taken, or which risks are considered when we take a ratio to determine risk ratio? What is in the numerator? What is in the denominator? Anybody remember?
Risk in the treatment group. Divided by risk in the control group.
Risk in the treatment group divided by risk in the control group. So we call this is ratio, so we call it risk ratio, right? And if risk ratio is 0.5, that means this treatment reduces the risk of mortality by 0.5. If this ratio is 0.5, then relative risk reduction will be
1
minus 0.5, which is 0.5, which means 50%. So, as we saw the other day, whenever we tailor treatment to individual patients, then we use what? Relative risk reduction means ratio measure or difference measure? Risk reduction, which is based on ratio measure. Difference measure, I told you, is to calculate the number needed to treat. You can calculate the individualized number needed to treat for each patient type. But you should remember that there are two measures, ratio measures, difference measures. Both are reported in some study reports. Some people report only one. But it is always, if you are reporting a randomized trial, report both. That will be perhaps better graded by the reviewers, and also those who are going to utilize this report may not have to do their own calculation. Otherwise, I told you that in general club, you ask your residents, particularly in medicine, in surgery, wherever there is intervention, to calculate number needed to treat from the difference. So remember, when we say risk in the treatment group divided by risk in the control group, how do we calculate the risk? Suppose outcome is death. So risk in the treatment group will be calculated by what?
Death by treatment event.
In the numerator will be?
Studies.
No, from the same study, you can
calculate.
In the treatment group, risk will be calculated as what?
Number of deaths upon
number of
treatment given.
Number of patients. Number of patients.
Yes, sir.
In that group. So risk in the treatment group is number of deaths in the treatment group divided by the number of patients in the treatment. Number of patients is in the denominator. So we said that is how you calculate percentage. No? So we said if there is mortality of 15% in the treatment group, 25% in the control group, then 15 upon 25 is the risk ratio, also called relative risk, right? So similarly, if we have to calculate risk of mortality in the control group, what will we do?
Number of deaths in the total number of patients.
Right, number of deaths in the control group divided by total number of patients in the. Rarely both groups will have the same number. If you have stopped the study at a time when distribution is equal in both the arms, but most of the time there will be difference of one or two patients between the treatment and control. So you have to calculate separately, right? Then take a ratio which will give you risk ratio. That risk ratio can be used to calculate relative risk reduction, which is applicable to the patient. Is it clear? So when we report randomized trial, we start with calculation of risk in the treatment group, then risk in the control group. We take a ratio and report it. Those who are going to use it, they have to calculate relative risk reduction and apply it to individual patients. Right? That is the main story. That is a very common parameter to be reported in randomized trials. But that is not the only one. We have seen in the last paper, they use different measures. One such measure was rate ratio, and we decided we will discuss what is rate ratio. Before we discuss, let me ask you, because you know Government of India scheme, Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Guarantee Scheme, everybody is aware, I think. Right? In short, it is called MNREGA. So in MNREGA, the payment is according to time by work. According to the number of people who work. Does anybody know? It depends on the time for which you have worked, right? Not according to the number of people who work. So sometimes it is said that a particular work in this Mahatma Gandhi Rural Employment Scheme, 150 people work for 50 man days to complete the work. So how does 150 people translate into 50 man days? Can anybody explain?
The people have come. People depend for all the days. Some days, some people depend.
So some days, some people did not work. So even though 150 people are involved in a work, the number of man days is less because everybody did not work every day, right? Any other way that it will be less than number of?
The amount of work done by three people was equal to amount of work done by one. So duty hours.
Duty hours. So duty hours may be what? Less? More?
Less
than a day. They may be working for?
Half
a day, or maybe few hours a day. So the calculation is done depending on hours one normally has in a working day, and then depending on the number of hours they have worked, you calculate man days, isn't it? And you told me that this payment is according to time, not according to number of persons, right? So man days is an expression of time or expression of persons?
Kind time.
Expression of time, please remember that, man days is expression of time, it's not number of men who worked in that, right? And what is wrong with the term by man days?
It can be woman
days also. It can be woman also who work in that one, so actually these people keep writing this. But what is your suggestion to the government? You use what?
Labor.
Instead of man days,
person
days, right? So actually, it would have been much nicer if the government used the word person day, not man day, because women also work there, right? That's right.
So working hour.
Person days is the way they express time. That is the language which they use. But you rightly said, person days is not expression of number of persons, it is expression of time. So remember that the payment is according to time, and person days is the unit in which they express time. Because that is how they calculate the wages. So let us consider two treatments, cancer treatment. And this is very simple math. If you treat, say, lung cancer is a very deadly disease, and you are comparing two treatments, one treatment, say, there are 50 people in one treatment, 50 people in another treatment. Right? So 10 people survive for 1 year. 10 people survive for 2 years, 10 people survive for 3 years, 10 people survive for 4 years, and 10 people survive for 5 years. What is 5 year survival? 10%, right? There is another treatment B, where 10 plus 10 plus 10 plus 10, 40 people survive for 4 years, right? And 10 people survive for 5 years. So what is 5 year survival? It is also 10%. But do you think both treatments are same? So which treatment is better? I will repeat my question. There are two treatments for lung cancer, 50-50 people in each one. In treatment A, 10 people survive for 1 year, 10 people for 2 years, 10 people for 3 years, 10 people 4 years, and 10 people for 5 years. So 5 year mortality is 10%. Treatment B, 40 people survive for 4 years. They die. So only 10 people survive for 5 years. So 5 year mortality survival is still 10%. But are the two treatments same? Which one is better?
Second one.
So this first one is better. Second one is better. How many people are in the first one? First one is better. How many people think second one is better? So, I think there is, you want to...
Regarding data, sir, that will give me more results. 10 people survive for 1 year, 10 people for 2 years. So, I will go towards the data, sir.
Yeah. So if you calculate, so that is where calculation of person years will come into, right? The person years of survival, which means 10 people surviving for 1 year means 10 person years, right? 10 people surviving for 20 years means 20 person years. And then another 10 surviving for 3 years means 30 person years. Then 10 people for 4 years, so 40 person years, and 10 people for 5 years, so 50 person years. So your trial is only for 5 years. So you will add this up, right? Then you will get 10 plus 20, 30 plus 30, 60 plus 40, 150% years. Whereas the second treatment, B, where there is 40 people are surviving for 4 years, right? So it is already 160 plus this 10% surviving for 50 years. So 160 plus 50 is 210% years. Is it okay, clear? So, sometimes if you only count number of persons, then you will do injustice to one treatment. if you don't count the time for which this treatment made the person to survive. So, in risk of mortality at the end of 4 years is same, perhaps 80%, 80% in both, isn't it? But in treatment A, 10 people kept on dying every year. So by the end of 4 years, how many people have died? 40 people have died. So you said risk in the treatment group divided by number of persons, which means 40 upon 50. That is 80%. 80% is the risk in treatment group A. And same 80% is at the end of 4 years is risk in treatment B. So if you just calculate only risk ratio will be equal to, at the end of 4 years, risk ratio will be equal to. So just think about it. We said 80% risk of mortality in treatment A, 80% in treatment B. So risk ratio is
1:1.
Yeah, that is what a risk ratio is. So if you only calculated risk ratio, you will be misled, isn't it? But 1 means no effect. But if you calculated number of person years at risk and number of death in the denominator, that will give you different picture. You get it? So risk ratio is not a good measure if your interest is to find out how long people survive. If time is of interest, then don't use risk ratio. Always time is of interest. Like in COVID, I'm sure those who have treated serious patients, they know every day it counts, isn't it? So time was counting. Everybody was counting time. How many days one will survive? The day was important. So time is always of interest, but time is not taken into account in risk ratio. So the people developed another measure. So you see, every measure has some value, but it doesn't complete the picture, right? So people go on changing, get better and better measure. So they realize that it is not good to have number of deaths divided by number of persons at risk of death, right? That is what we did so far. They said, no, you have number of deaths in the numerator and number of person years of at risk in the denominator, right? So, if you remember, we always had in our physics classes, how did we define speed? Anybody remember? Distance covered or displacement divided by time, right? So that was definition of speed.
Velocity was defined in
a particular direction, how much is the displacement divided by time. And anybody remembers what was acceleration?
Speed, velocity,
divided by time. So time is always in the denominator. Whenever you think of rate has time in the denominator. Right? So now, can you guess what will be the definition of rate ratio? Our rate, mortality rate. We always talk about risk of mortality. Now we are talking about mortality rate, right? So rate means there should be
same but per unit time.
Incidence, Suskaniga.
Time duration.
Number of? You are saying
death by time.
I told you, when you are dealing with persons, like in Manrega, you have another way to express time, and time is in person days. In treatment, you can have person days also, but most of the time, if you have long term study, then person years will be. So it may be person days, person weeks, person months, person years, right? It should be. That is how you would denote time. So number of deaths in the numerator, number of person days or person years at risk in the denominator. That will give you rate. So we talked about mortality, risk of mortality. Now we are talking of rate of mortality. So whenever you change from risk to rate, then denominator will change. Denominator will not be number of persons at risk. It will
person
be
in time.
Person time at risk. Person time. Right. So if you do that in treatment group, you do that in control group. If you take a ratio, then that will be called rate. Right. So now you can show the slides. You have understood this at least rate ratio concept. You see this. Like patients with COVID is hypertension. Next, and see how they express the result. Death within 28 days occurred in 421 patients, that is 25%. And rate ratio, right? Which means, though, but 421 patients died in 21 days in the hydroxychloroquine group, in the denominator, they must have kept what? Person days in the denominator, right? So number of person days at risk. Number of patients at risk? No. Number of person days at risk. And similarly, in the control group, 790 patients died, but they must have taken 790 divided by person number of person days at risk. Then they calculated rate ratio, which gave them 1.01. And there is a way to calculate confidence interval around rate ratio, which gave 0.97 to 1.23. If it was exactly 1, that means treatment has no effect. 1.01 means which group is worse? Treatment group is worse, right? And then you can see 95% confidence interval, which is including 1, and therefore treatment has not. But in the same paper, last paragraph, second paragraph is also about rate ratio, right? In the last paragraph, they say, among the patients who are undergoing mechanical ventilation at baseline, though in the hydroxychloroquine group, had a higher frequency of invasive mechanical ventilation or death, right? And there we calculate risk ratio. So if you do 30.7, which is in the treatment group, and 26.9, which is in the control group, then it will give you
1.14,
right? So if you don't believe them, you can check, right? This is what it will give you, the risk ratio. Now the question which you might ask is, why did they change? Why did they change? This is express rate ratio, rate ratio, then they come to risk ratio. Anybody can guess? You see, the second one is discharge from hospital alive. Within 28 days, right? Then those in the usual care group. So rate ratio. What must be in the denominator and numerator?
Number of deaths.
Number of
discharges.
Number of discharge alive, right? And in the denominator, person days. Person day. Number of person days. But when they come to undergoing mechanical ventilation, invasive mechanical ventilation or death, then they change to risk ratio. So I asked one in one of the general, why did they change? Anybody can think of the reason? We can only guess, but I think your guess will be that. Why did they change? Time for what? And death, everybody knows the date, right? Date of death is recorded in death certificate. So date of death is known. You can calculate from date how many number of days the person was alive. Person days can be calculated.
Invasive mechanical ventilation.
No, date was not recorded. Date on which they put the patient on mechanical ventilation, invasive mechanical ventilation, was not recorded. If you go into their form, they did not perhaps ask people whether invasive mechanical ventilation, yes or no. And they didn't ask date on which invasive mechanical ventilation was. So their form was either incomplete or people didn't follow it, right? They did not put the date. So if you don't know the date,
but
then you can't calculate.
The consent there should be there for invasive ventilation. No.
Oh, but madam, consent is actually.
No, but if consent letter is signed there, then if patient is
consent. So it doesn't match them. Even if a patient gives a consent today, we may put the patient on ventilator tomorrow.
That means my date of consent may not be same as date of mechanical ventilation. This is why they said forget about we can't count the number of person dates. That is unless you have the date. So date is very important if you want to know the rate ratio. If you don't know the date, then you can only calculate risk rate. You can't calculate risk rate. So date is very important. And you may be thinking it must be recorded in every data. It doesn't happen. Many a times, death, yes or no, everybody knows. But date of death, you don't know. Because it was not recorded. At least not in the form of data. So when you are making data collection form, you better keep that in mind. That at every event, if you can ask for date, then only you can calculate person days. If you don't calculate person days, then like my example, you will miss an important treatment effect. And I think a good example of that, which is affecting perhaps all malaria patients in the world, is this dexamethasone trial of cerebral malaria, which said steroid is useless, did not count the number of days. They only counted death, yes or no. And from their own data, I have written a copyright review on that and said, from their own data, you cannot exactly calculate, but you can speculate that probably dexamethasone patients survived longer. But they did not calculate the number of days. They only noted fact of death, not the date of death. So they missed an important treatment effect. They might have missed. This is what I raised as a question in my Cochrane review. And when I was writing this, my co-author was from Liverpool and I was in Liverpool. So when I raised this question, this happens in UK also, said, no, don't write this. He's a big guy, you know, he will smash my career, you don't know. Don't write that it was a miscalculation or anything like this, right? Just leave it as it is reported. Anyway, I insisted and I have written that at least we should write that more trials are needed. Because, again, they might have missed an important treatment. Right? Because they only took, those who are in medicine, they will know, they define cerebral malaria by coma. So those who are almost terminal, what will dexamethasone do? It will only prolong survival a little bit, isn't it? But you didn't count the prolongation of survival. So you missed a very important treatment effect. It's published in the England Journal, published by Oxford Group, but these things were not very much, people were not aware. That is why they missed perhaps an important treatment effect. Wrong definition, only comatose patients were taken, which is not correct. All patients of cerebral malaria are not comatose. Right? Your definition was wrong, that only if you are terminal, then you are cerebral malaria. This is not right. Treatment will work if the patients are relatively better preserved. Means they have altered sensorium but not comatose. If you give to comatose people, then what will happen? Only it will prolong survival, which you did not count. So you missed an important treatment effect. So wrong patients, wrong counting of treatment effect, and the whole world changed. Abandoned dexamethasone, isn't it? This is what, because it was published in the England Journal of Medicine, so every textbook started writing it, including Harrison, Davidson, everyone, and then people stopped it. After I wrote this Cochrane review, one Dr. Darrow, who is a neurologist in the USA, he wrote a letter to me that I like your Cochrane review because I have always felt dexamethasone works. And he sent a paper which he has written in a small journal, it's not very well known. But look here, I was working in Army, US Army, and I was in Vietnam. And I have done this study and published, but nobody bothers to read it. And his conclusion is it works. It saves lives. And I don't know how these Oxford people have conducted this study, and they. So what I'm trying to say is, you have to open your eyes. Everything which is in textbook is not correct, right? But you have to understand where people things went wrong, and then you can raise a question. And I told Malaria Group, National Malaria Group, that you better. We don't see cerebral malaria anymore. Study is maybe one or two patients in a year. So those who see, they should do another trial of non-comatose patients and count the number of days of survival, not only the number of deaths. So calculate rate ratio, not risk ratio. Even if they had done rate ratio, they might have found significant benefit. That is what you can expect. So it is all open now, and still in, you ask medicine people, this is what you teach, no? Don't use dexamethasone. Am I right or not?
Yes, sir.
This is what you are teaching, no? Based on one study of about 100 patients or so, which is underpowered study, poorly defined patients, poorly counted outcomes, and the whole world changed the policy, right? Because nobody, neither the planners knew these things, nor readers know these things. Therefore, myth continues, right? So you, this editor told me that cerebral malaria, there will be no further studies. So can we call it a closed chapter? I said, no, somebody will do a study someday. Let it remain open, let them read. And I have said that more studies are needed. Somebody will do it, who knows? You can't close it. So we had a lot of debate. He became very angry with me. So I said, no, I will not close. So it's not closed yet. Closed means they archive it, you know, so nobody, no further trials will be done. So there is no need for further review. I said, no, I won't take it.
Paul Gardner,
yes. How do you know him?
The Fortin of Tensor.
Paul Gardner. So he is a big WHO consultant and all that, but that's beside the point. But next. So the, this is how outcome, choice of outcome the way you measure is. So you see, number of people is in the first column, number of deaths in 10 years in another column, and what is this 10 years CI?
Cumulative, sir.
So cumulative incidence. And cumulative incidence is another way to say risk, right? Cumulative incidence is also called. Actually, risk is not a very good word because there is a paper recently I was reading. Risk of cure. Does it sound okay?
Mm-hmm.
No? Why? What is wrong with this? Risk of cure. Cure is a good thing. So, what is the risk in this? Right? So, risk is one sided word which is only in favor of unfavorable outcome. So, some people have rightly said, say incidence of cure. Incidence of death, incidence of cure. It is a neutral word, no? It works both ways, whether it is favorable outcome or unfavorable outcome. This is why some people say, use the word incidence. And incidence can be risk, incidence can be rate. So, to distinguish for risk, cumulative incidence is another word. And incidence rate is another word. I think it will come later. Next. Alright. So, I think Amit wanted to say something about this slide. What do you want to say?
Different slide, sir. This one, the cumulative incidence, what is the
right. So, cumulative incidence is two people have died. So, you will count number of deaths, 2, divided by number of people. This is how many?
9. It is not.
Anyway, number is, if each person is reported like that, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So 2 by 8. So risk or cumulative incidence will be 2 divided by 8 is 0.25. In percentage, you will call it 25%. So 25% is the cumulative incidence, 25% will also be called risk, right? Because risk is okay, here we are talking about death, which is an unfavorable outcome. So 20% is the risk. But we didn't count what?
Time.
We didn't count time of death. So if you do that, then you have to count all these days. Next.
It's an incidence.
Alright. So in incidence rate, you have number of events, which is death in this case, divided by time at risk, person time at risk. So if you add them up, it will be for a population, right? So as you were saying, control group population or this experimental group population, it is population time at risk because you are adding all the person, there is your person years for the whole population. That is what incidence rate is, right? Next, anything else?
Yes.
So same thing, number of individuals who develop the outcome of interest during the observation period, and denominator is total amount of time at risk for all the subjects who were being followed. So amount of time, time is in the denominator. And you said speed, time is in the denominator. Velocity, time is in the denominator. So whenever we talk of rate, time is in the denominator. Now having said that, I should, those who read there, I don't know how many of you have read Dave Sackett of McMaster University. He has written a book which I don't know people have read, and even their students who have come up with another book which is called User's Guide to Medical Literature. They use the word event rate, and event rate is equal to number of events divided by number of persons at risk. So it is not rate. If it is number of persons in the denominator, it is not rate. It should have been number of person time. So even though they use the word event rate, actually they are talking about event risk ratio, right? Which means even experts make mistakes in choosing the word. When they say rate, they mean actually risk or proportion. So when you are reading, be careful. Even though it is a well-known textbook and people read it all over the world, but they use the word event rate when they actually mean event risk or event incidence. Still better word is incidence rather than risk, because risk is tailored to unfavorable, right? But we can't change it because the whole world is using risk. Ideal thing would have been to use the word cumulative incidence and incidence rate. It will be okay for mortality also, for cure also, for improvement also, for mitigation also. Incidence is a neutral word. But the whole world is still using risk. So we have to use risk, which means we have to use unfavorable outcome. Next. So, same thing which we have, I already told you, speed and velocity. Actually, those of you who want to revise, a series was written by me and in some chapters with a colleague of mine in Neurology India. Neurology India is a official journal of Neurological Society of India. So they wanted me to write about... The editor varies, changes his place depending on who is elected. At this time, AIIMS person is editor, but it is not Journal of AIIMS, it is Journal of Neurological Society of India. So if you want to revise all this is published in Neurology India. Next. Right. So I have already told you that some textbooks use the word event rate, but what the name is event risk, because denominator does not have person time, it has number of persons at risk. So person time at risk and persons at risk makes the whole difference. Next. So Amit, you wanted to say something about this?
This is the example what we have learned now about the person event. So this is the hypothetical example, a cohort study, 5-year follow-up. So there were 5 person. So first person alive in the 5-year, second person 4th year he followed and the event occurred, third person at 4th year it happened, and similarly for the 4th person into 12 the event occurred. This is the data was collected. So if we want to calculate year at risk for the first person, he was alive till 5th year. So person year is the 5 mass for that person. So second individual, you see 4.5 year he remained in the study cohort. Third person 3.5 year he remained in the cohort after that the event occurred. So sensor. Fourth person 1.5 year and the fifth person 3.5 year, and there were lost of follow-up for the fifth person. So at the time of lost to follow, we have to censor at that. So if you want to calculate the incident rate in which the person year should be there, so number of the event will come to the denominator, and at the numerator and the in the denominator the total person. So you have to add up. If you are adding every month, 18 is coming. So if you divide with the number of the event, 3 events it occurred, divided by 18, so it is coming 0.167 person year. So we can express it 16.7 100 person year. In this way, we represent the person year.
But fourth one will need to adjust.
Fourth one, he is giving you year wise. But if you want to develop a survival curve, then you have to move it towards the left side here. Not for just counting, but if you want to create a curve, then you have to shift it to the beginning. So I think we can stop here. Any question? So you know what is rate ratio. You can a full name will be incidence rate ratio, right? But in brief, we call it rate ratio, right? And there can be rate difference also, which is not that you can't have a difference measure in that. So remember, for every measure, there is a ratio and there is a difference, right? So incidence rate difference can also be one of the measures. But we are only talking about incidence rate ratio, right? So you can have rate difference, rate ratio. Risk difference, risk ratio. We don't have odds difference, we have only odds ratio, right? Because odds itself is a ratio of two ratios. So we only stick to ratio. So there is nothing prevents us to make odds difference as another measure, but nobody has used it so far. So that is what we wanted to cover today. Any question? We will not do hazard ratio today. And I'm not sure whether people are really interested to know this. I think we should, these are all effect measures, effect size measures, right? So measures of effect size, I think there are three papers in Virology India which we have written. You can revise your what we have done. Same thing we have written there. So you can revise by reading those papers. And then we have also included hazard ratio in one of the write-up. If you are interested, you can read it. It's a slightly more complicated concept, which I think you need not go into. But you should know how to use it, or how to interpret it. Rate ratio also use it like risk ratio. And hazard ratio also use it like risk ratio. When you are applying to individual patients, we are interpreting. So risk ratio of 1 means, is there any effect of the treatment?
No
effect of the treatment. If you define risk ratio as risk in the treatment group divided by risk in the control group, everybody doesn't do that, right? If you do it this way, then less than 1 means treatment works or treatment works. Treatment works or treatment is beneficial. If risk ratio is more than 1, that means treatment is harmful. So side effects always come more than 1. Beneficial effect less than 1. If you stick to this formula that experimental group or treatment group is in the numerator and control group is the denominator. If you reverse it, then beneficial treatment will have more than 1 risk ratio, right? So sometimes people reverse it, sometimes they follow it. Cochrane says that follow it. Always treatment group in the numerator and control group in the denominator. Not always people follow this. Therefore, you need not, you have to check what they are doing. Alright? If you don't check it, you may completely miss the point. So, always check what is happening, which way percentage is going, and which way ratio is going. Right. So hazard ratio, you only need to know it is basically if you calculate risk ratio at 1 year, 2 years, 3 years, 4 years, then you average it. Then the conceptually at least that is what hazard ratio.
This one looks like hazard ratio. This presentation of this data.
No, it is. It is hazard is slightly different. I don't think everybody needs to know. How many people want to know hazard ratio? You see, I think, I don't know. I can't count it right now, but I think it's 50-50. So we will have a separate class for hazard ratio. Yes.
Sir, rate ratio of the whole incidence ratio.
Incidence ratio.
Compare karega na two incidence ko rate ratio. Can you give it by?
Incidence rate, if it is about mortality, incidence of mortality in or incidence rate of mortality in experimental group divided by incidence rate of mortality in control group. That will be called incidence rate ratio. In short, one way, right? Full word is incidence rate ratio. Right. And this incidence rate is also called average hazard rate. Right? That is another word used for this. Average hazard rate. Don't bother about this, but just remember that you treat hazard ratio as risk ratio. Interpret it that way. Hazard ratio of 1 means no treatment. Hazard ratio less than 1 means treatment is beneficial. Hazard ratio more than 1 means treatment is probably harmful. But check the percentages also. Sometimes people reverse it. So that much knowledge about hazard ratio is good enough. If you are asked to say about hazard ratio, you can say risk ratio averaged over time is hazard ratio. So beyond that is little more involved. Yes.
Acute illness, rate ratio
is better, risk
ratio. Risk ratio will be better because rate ratio, even if it is this 2 or 3 days
prolongation in there.
So you are right. So fallaciously giving an idea that it is improving, but it is just prolonging there.
You are right.
Acute illness is rate ratio.
Yes, you are right. If it is a long-term study or long-term follow-up, then rate is a must, right? Rate is must. If it's short-term study and short-term outcome, then risk ratio will serve the purpose.
But,
right? But as you have seen, COVID data was 28 days, right? So 28 days they have reported rate ratio. You have seen that in hydroxychloroquine also. Tocilizumab also was 28 days,
yes,
or 30 days, whatever. But they have reported rate ratio. So what you have to look at is how much is the, that is why difference is also important. That is what gives you idea how much is the magnitude of effect, right? If rate ratio is 0.25, let us see, which means 75% reduction, isn't it? That will be certainly, whatever number of days we are talking about, will be perhaps beneficial to the patient. Patients will generally consider it important. So that's why we say what is statistically significant may not be same as clinically important. Always look at the magnitude of effect. So you are talking about magnitude of effect, how many days it could last, right? So sometimes it may be important, sometimes it may not be. But when people are reporting, it is better to check how much is the magnitude of it, how many days you are prolonged. So it's a good question, and you should always ask that question. And that is why difference measure is also important. You are talking of how much difference it makes, how many days difference, right? Yes, when it is in years, nobody will doubt that. When it is in days, then it is a matter of opinion. Just one day, is it good enough or not? Doctor,
instead of days, because for acute illness, what madam is saying, instead of days, if you convert to hours, then,
then it becomes more questionable.
More complicated.
Yeah, treatment. No, not complicated. You can calculate. So, diarrhea study, they calculate hours.
Yes, sir.
Right. Asthma study. How long asthma lasts? If it comes to emergency, 2 hours, 3 hours. Then he goes back home.
Yeah.
So that is in hours only. So some study will even report rate of remission or rate of improvement in bronchial asthma also, which, as Dr. Pragya Pant is saying, is ridiculous. All we want to know is whether patient improved or not.
Yes.
So, rate, which is will be by hours, is meaningless, clinically not important. But people just to, so which one will give you lower p-value, rate or risk?
Rate.
Rate will give you lower p-value, so people to get P value less than 0.05, they sometimes change from risk to rate. Rate is more sensitive. But what you are asking is it clinically important or not? So, yes, I agree that when people report rate, still you look at how much is the magnitude of improvement, right? And whether it is clinically important or not. That is the whole point. That is what evidence-based medicine is saying, that don't look only at p-value, look at the magnitude of effect. And magnitude of effect is better reflected in difference, not in ratio. That is why we talked about risk difference, number needed to treat. So number needed to treat tells you magnitude of effect. Alright? So better you look at those things before you decide to use this treatment. Not only because New England Journal of Medicine has reported it, p-value is significant, therefore we should use it. No. You should ask yourself, how much is the difference treatment is making? That requires closer reading, right? Even if you forget about all the statistics, you will at least understand how many percent people died in treatment group, how many percent people died in control group. Just look at the percentages and think, is it good enough for the amount of cost, risk, and inconvenience associated with this treatment? That is the whole point. Before this evidence-based practice came, people only looked at the p-value and only whether it is significant or not. So now what we are saying is, no, look at the magnitude of it. Because every treatment has cost, every treatment has risk, every treatment has some inconvenience. Even if a person has to take injection, that means there is pain. And the taking injection means you have to be in hospital or you have to call a compounder or somebody who gives injection. So it is a source of inconvenience. So on the cost, risk, and inconvenience associated with the treatment, and think whether magnitude of effect is worth it or not. So worth of the treatment has to be seen before you adopt it, before you use it, before you prescribe it. That is the whole point. So the question you are raising is absolutely right. But when you are reporting it, then you have to follow the consort statement, which is you have to calculate depending on the type of study, risk ratio, rate ratio. What you are saying is, why did they calculate rate ratio? They would have reported risk ratio, that would have been fine. I agree with you. They would have done that. But maybe it was just, you can say, statistician who advised that you have rate of death, so why don't you calculate rate? So they went for, or maybe somebody has done it and clinicians don't know how to say yes. Or now you are asking that you will give suggestion that you better report this.
Any logon ne to complicate kiya ki aao mere paas likho.
ये बोल रहे हैं डॉक्टर जयप्रकाश पीछे वाले नहीं सुन रहे हैं कि वो बेसिकली जो है इसलिए रिपोर्ट करते हैं कि स्टैटिस्टिशियन कहते हैं मेरे पास आओ यार सब समझ जाओगे तो तुम अपने कर लोगे. रिस्क थोड़ा इजी है, आप अपने कैलकुलेटर में करके रिपोर्ट कर सकते हो. कॉन्फिडेंस इंटरवल के लिए जाना पड़ेगा. लेकिन आजकल तो कैलकुलेटर है, लेकिन वो बेसिकली कह रहे हैं कि इसलिए कंफ्यूज रखते हैं कि आप हमारे पास आते रहो. ठीक है, एनी अदर क्वेश्चन? ओके, थैंक यू वेरी मच.
सर वो फ्राइडे होना चाहिए. फ्राइडे,
हाँ. सो डॉक्टर भट्टाचार्य इज आस्किंग, कैन वी डू इट ऑन फ्राइडे, बिकॉज ही